The market for premium controllers has grown vastly since they started to get introduced around the PS3 and Xbox 360 generations. Even Microsoft themselves has gotten into the business of offering both their own set of custom design controllers and elite premium controllers. I personally was never too interested in the practice. An advanced controller for at times half of or more than the price of my console? I'll just stick to the one that comes with the box. That's also partially why I was curious to see what the hype was about, and when Hexgaming emailed offering a review unit of their new custom DualSense, I thought, why not? Let's see if there's any merit to these controllers. But before we jump into this review, make sure you hit that subscribe button and hit the bell icon to stay up to date on my reviews. According to YouTube, only 10% of you watching are subscribed, so make sure you get subscribed. Hexgaming offers a handful of customizable features for this controller. As you can see, I went with an all black look with a soft touch finish. I really like the design of the stealth black consoles, so I really wanted the DualSense in that style. The faceplate is now black, and all the buttons, including the D-pad, face buttons, share, and option buttons, are all black. The PlayStation home button has been replaced by a circular button with Hex's logo on it. The bottom faceplate remains black on my controller, and the same goes for the shoulder buttons. The back of the controller can also have a textured water drip-like back to it, but I opted for the soft touch black finish instead. In person, I really like the design and the overall finish of everything. It's a more soft and comfortable feeling controller compared to the original DualSense. Having an actual circular button for the home button instead of the PlayStation logo feels surprisingly better, and after using this controller, it almost feels weird to have that textured backing on the original DualSense. Those are just some of the visual changes. Let's talk about the actual features you can get with this thing. So every one of these controllers comes with remappable paddles that lay behind the DualSense. I was surprised to see only two paddles on this thing, without any other features. Based on what I've seen on the market, four paddles are the usual, and sometimes they even feature things like a turbo switch. These are just straight up two simple digital paddles that at least can be remapped to anything on the controller on the fly without any third-party software. Programming it is as easy as holding down the button on the back to turn it on, hold down the paddle you want to remap, and the button you're trying to map it to for 3 seconds. That's it. Once you're done editing, hold back the button on the paddles again to turn off the editing mode, and that's it. It's incredibly simple, and I appreciate being able to make those changes on the fly without much hassle. The other features you can add to the controller is a fast shot digital button. These cut the travel distance for the shoulder buttons, making your fire rate in games like first person shooters improve by a decent margin since you're not waiting for the controller to register those shots as much. The trade-off is that games that use analog triggers, like racing games, do suffer from the digital buttons. You really have to juggle what types of games you play and decide whether you want it or not. I play more shooters than I do racing games, so I opted for the new buttons. However, if you want to do something similar without changing the triggers, you can also just map the shoulder buttons to the paddles for a similar effect. Included in the box alongside the controllers were replaceable analog sticks. By default, they come with these concave sticks with little dots on the top. I like the wider surface on these, but I prefer not having the dots on the analog stick. They do include other sticks, but some of them are just slightly raised versions of these sticks, and the other one being is something similar to the DualShock 3, which I wasn't the biggest fan of. Now, I've been using this controller for the last few days, playing the vast library of about 4 good first-party PS5 games out right now, and there's a lot I like, but some things that I miss with the original controller as well. First, the ergonomics of this controller feel way better in my opinion over the original DualSense. The soft touch finish feels comfortable, and the paddle placement feels well in practice. I do find it odd that more paddles were included or that you can't even change the speed of the two that are included. I like the larger surface area of the sticks, but I wish they felt more like the Xbox sticks rather than just having these dots all over the place. Having a button instead of the PlayStation logo for a home button is great, though I wish I had the option to just not have a logo on it. I get you want to have branding and stuff, but if you're paying this much for a controller, then I think not having branding should be justified. Now, playing shooters on this was pretty interesting because for one, it felt great having digital triggers on shooters like Call of Duty Warzone. However, new shooters that actually use the analog lock feature, like Returnal, just didn't register that mid-trigger pull. If a lot of shooters start to take advantage of that on the PS5, that could totally kill the use of this controller for those games, which once again makes perhaps just having the paddles the better choice. Alright, let's talk about the elephant in the room. This thing's not cheap, and I don't want you thinking that I'm some big shot paying $200 to $300 for a controller thinking you should too. I grew up making minimum wage, so believe me, I know these things are expensive, but they're also not really meant for the casual player either. After all, these are controllers that charge $30 just to have the shoulder buttons shortened, so you can save a few milliseconds on pushing them. If that doesn't describe you, then this probably isn't the controller for you, right? Well, this controller does start at $250, and that's just the base colors with the paddle. do all the changes I did, like the colors and the shoulder buttons, and you hit $302. Funny enough, I used Honey to find a promo code that gave me $15 off, so it was more like $287. Honey's not a sponsor of this channel, but I do use them, so if you aren't watching this, Honey, sponsor me please. YouTube Grammarly, I unironically use both of you all the time. Anyway, at $287, or $302, this is one expensive controller, but shockingly not as bad as I thought when I started to look around the market. Aim Controller, for example, has a similar product, but they offer four paddles that I believe are pre-mapped, and that goes for $370. That's almost about another $100 on top of the old controller, and you're basically almost at PS5 digital prices before taxes. If you just want the color changes and nothing else modified, then you can go with the DualSense from Colorware for about $149, and you're saving about $140 on the paddles and the shoulder buttons. So Hexgaming finds their controller somewhere in the middle of these two, offering slight features of both. When compared to the rest of the market, the price is sort of justified, but these are just way too expensive for what they offer, and it would be cheaper to ultimately just buy your own controller, some replacement shells, and a screwdriver. But of course, that's not accounting for the labor that goes into doing this yourself. Even then, I don't think this should be costing you more than $200 top. You can get a brand new Xbox Elite controller for $180, and a custom design controller without the paddles for about $80. Those aren't DualSense, admittedly, those are Xbox controllers, but it goes to show how much of a gap there is in the pricing for custom controllers. Prices are high because you can't really get a DualSense customized easily right now, unless you do it yourself, but with the constraint on the market, this just feels way too upcharged, even in this marketplace that is traditionally already expensive. The Hexgaming Rival controller is a great feeling controller that strikes a balance between customizing the look of the controller and the feature set as well. I enjoyed using it while playing Sony's latest offerings on the PS5, and was happy to see the DualSense specific features like haptic feedback all in working order despite some modifications. However, this is nowhere near a $280 to $300 controller, and I don't think anyone should be paying that much for one. $150 to $200, maybe if they added some more features like the paddles and modifiers for them, but certainly not for what you get in the box. Thank you very much for watching my review. If you found it informative and entertaining, then please consider subscribing. I make reviews for usually video games, but today just happens to be a hardware review. In the comments below, let me know your favorite controller. I'd probably go with the Xbox Series X controller, but I do wish it had the DualSense haptic triggers. That'd be a perfect controller for me. Anyway, until the next video, I'll talk to you in the comments down below or over on my free Discord server. The invite is in the description.